My next guest is Bud Conrad. He joins us from Casey Research. And Bud, on the day you and I are speaking on Thursday, they've bailed out Greece. They've written down the debt. The credit default swaps don't have to be triggered because it's considered voluntary. The world problems have been solved. The stock market's up. Is it time to break out the champagne?
Boy, it sure seems like it. With the stock market up, with gold up, interest rates up a little, that's a worrisome sign. But grains hitting limits on some of the contracts, copper, oil up, everything is euphoric. Well, I'm a little more of a skeptic, as you know, Jim. I've been at this for a while. And a given euphoric day, particularly from rumors from Europe, I think is something more likely to be faded than believed. But this is a big one, and it's probably worth a little review of its strength as well as its weaknesses. The strength is they really have said kind of what the big picture outline plan is in terms of the fact that they're going to give a specific bailout to the people who own bad Greek debt at a 50% level. That is, the banks themselves are saying they will voluntarily, I emphasize that word because I don't really believe it, take a haircut of 50%. The banks are supposed to recapitalize themselves from roughly around 6% to about 9% Tier 1 capital ratios. Not quite sure where they'll get the money for that. But the biggie behind all this that everybody is so enthusiastic about is that the EFSF, which is the European Financial Stability Facility, is constituted at 440 billion euros, supposed to be able to triple, quadruple by borrowing its size of bailout support money to make all these things happen by borrowing. There's a little bit of a slip, I think, in that last one that's pretty serious. Who's going to loan them money? I don't think I'm going to go dig into my savings account. I don't think many large banks have feeling confidence that this will be able to manage it. It's going to have to be backed up by the ECB somehow, the European Bank. But I think that between promise and reality there is a pretty big gap in the sense that to get somebody to loan to this sort of nation fund, they're going to have to give away a whole heck of a lot in terms of perhaps fine print, back of the room, smoke-filled room deals of guarantees to get the incentive to actually make the loan. We won't quite know what that is. We may never know all the details of it, but it'll be huge amounts of guarantees, which basically means the taxpayers are still on the hook to make this whole thing hold together. And their question of the extent of the political will, of the probabilities of all of this coming through, I think are still at risk. In particular, I think France is right on the edge of a downgrade of its own debt in the sense of funding this, and the German citizenry feels duped by Merkel, who promised that there would be no leverage of the EFS when they finally got around to supporting the EFS in the Bundestag. And the Bundestag people are saying, you told us, Angela, that we wouldn't be doing this leverage, but in fact you are. We're unhappy. She may lose her political power. Who knows how this flows? But you don't make something out of nothing. This isn't alchemy. This isn't finance. There isn't money here unless you print it up. And so for the fact that the euro went up to 142 today, I consider a real vulnerability that, frankly, I don't have a position in it, but I would be, if I were more actively a currency trader, would be looking to fade because I honestly don't believe that things have changed as much as they have. And one piece of this is also a vulnerable aspect, and I'm getting a little long-winded, but I want to get to it, is that the credit default swap business has always been a murky, somewhat unregulated, crazy business in which fortunes have been made and lost. In particular was the Achilles heel of our backing for our subprime mortgages, where things were rated much out of line what they should be, and the credit default swaps offered on those and other things that collapsed. Today has gone through another major revision because since this was a voluntary 50% cut, the CDS is probably not going to be triggered as laid out by the International Swaps and Derivatives Association, who decides such things, which means that even though you had a 50% loss, there is no guarantee, which means CDS, as they're laid out, are basically bankrupt. And part of the reason for that is the International Swaps and Derivatives Association is run by all the banks who don't want to have to pay it. So J.P. Morgan gets a free card, get out of jail card again. This is
so does Goldman.
Corrupt to want to play this game too long and too far. And my belief is where taxpayers are still on the hook, because the reality is somebody's going to have to come up with something, and the bankers are going scot-free. Yet again, I don't like it, but that's, you know, my negative kind of view about how this is unraveling.
Well, you know, Bud, I want to stay on credit default swaps for a moment, because one of the things I don't like about the way that market functions is if I'm Goldman Sachs, or let's say I'm J.P. Morgan, I write it a credit default swap on Greek debt. In exchange for that, whoever buys that credit default swap from me pays me a premium. Now, unlike an insurance company that insures your home and car, when they take premiums, they have to set money aside in case, you know, your house burns down or you get in a car accident. But with credit default swaps, the premiums you take in, you book as profits and you bonus it out to yourself, so that, like in the case of AIG, they had no reserves to back up when these bonds went kaput. This is the way this market still functions today. To me, it's a ticking time bomb.
Exactly. I think you stated it. And your detail of how this works is well explained there. It's sort of like, well, my house burned halfway down. You're not going to pay my fire insurance on my house because it didn't burn all the way down? I mean, it's crazy. They're writing their own rules in a very self-serving way that strikes me as close to corrupt. But, you know, I mean, we didn't say that the world is fair. It's just... So where does this go? What worries me is that people's euphoria about this, saying, oh, Europe is fixed, there won't be any problem, is that they won't clear it out until they start paying the bills. And the paying the bills, in my view, is further taxes in Europe, further government bailouts, further government printing, especially when they have to give the ECB the power to back up the guarantees to the loans to the ESFF. And when that happens, I think we recognize what is our basic story that Jim and you and I have been talking about a lot. You can't trust the paper money systems of the world. And Europe does come through a much more serious convulsion economically. I think that's still in the cards. And the reason I bring that up is because that will affect what I think is the next biggest convulsion in the world, is that if Europe fails, I think people then will start looking around to what the effect of that could be in the overall world markets, particularly to some of the people that export a lot and send a lot of goods to Europe, particularly China is what I'm thinking about, Asia. I think there is a bubble there that is totally uncovered, whereas everybody's talking all day long about Europe for the last 3 months. Nobody's talking about the bubble of China, which I think is in some ways more serious because it's bigger and deeper. Somehow Europe will muddle through. They have not gone through World War II with this financial crisis, and they aren't going to, with a future decreasing attractiveness of the euro currency. That doesn't murder people. And in China, they're not talking deaths either. But I am thinking that there are serious problems that lead to a bubble there, which will probably occur after the European bubble bursts. That's the way I am viewing the dominoes of this situation.
You know, Bud, it almost strikes me that what we're going to see is a series of dominoes. And this reminds me of the credit crisis. You know, it began with the intermediate lenders, then it got up to folks like Bear Stearns, Lehman Brothers, and then, of course, Merrill and the whole thing. Could we see a situation where it's, you know, the world's focused on right now Europe? And so the dollar has been a big beneficiary of that, because my favorite saying is we own the best-looking house in a bad neighborhood. But could we see this to move on to Asia next with China and Japan? Because unlike the last two decades, Japan's population is aging. Their savings rate is going down, and where in the past two decades they were able to, let's say, refinance or pay for most of their debt internally, now those people are aging, they're living on their savings, even though Japan goes from, you know, one stimulus program to the next. Is a move to Asia next after Europe?
That's my scenario. The one that worries me in China is that they have really already overdone their combination of bailout and real estate bubble compared to what the Europeans are now doing and we did during our attempt to paper over our mortgage subprime and then a cascading debt crisis that is now turning into a sovereign debt rather than private debt crisis in both the United States and Europe. We see it moving from one step to another of dominoes in the movement from private debt, mortgage debt, to mistrust of government, sovereign debt, which is the Europe Greek crisis. And I think the same thing is going to happen in China. They have overinvested in just an amazing way. Let me not detract from the movement of China from backward countries that Deng Xiaoping into the new century with economic growth in a time when we as a world were supporting them with an opening trade attitude towards China at the same time that they'd had a demographic bubble, particularly China, and I'm talking about here, of the one-child policy, so they had a very active young worker force to rely on for their economic growth. But all three of those are turning backwards. Local governments have too much debt. Local banks have accumulated risky loans. The growth is slowing if you remove the government stimulus. The inflation is high in China, 6.2% official, and it's probably higher than that, as world prices of oil are now escalating at the level of affecting all kinds of economies. But the property bubble in China, it matches what Japan went through in 1990. And is, in my view, already about to burst. They have built cities. You can see beautiful photographs of them from the air, which include shopping centers and factories in the periphery and high-rises in the middle, and the only thing they're missing is people. How can you do this and then call it part of GDP? It's wasted investment. You build factories and you don't have anything to do in them because China's no longer the cheapest supplier of labor in Asia. You can go to Indonesia, you can go to other countries, and they are doing it themselves. So this bubble may burst in an environment that's no longer as friendly to them. And that bursts all three of the things I've just talked about, of the reforms that opened up their economy, the reforms where the world opened up the economy, and the workforce that is now also starting to age in China, as the one child now has to support the retirement of two parents and four grandparents. And when you put all that together, I think that even though they have a command economy, which did smooth over their effects of the last world downturn in 2008-2009, but at what cost? The cost of a 58% increase in their money supply. That can't be avoided as having an inflationary effect on the purchasing power of their own currency. And with their currency controls on capital account, I think that the renminbi is not going to be an attractive investment. And if it weren't for a purchasing power difference where you can buy things cheaply in China, I would be voting against the rise of the renminbi, at least at the level that many people are predicting of 30 or 40%. And then if they really do have the bust that I am worrying could be occurring, what's next? What's the implication of that? One thing that worries me a lot, because I have been a bettor on the fact that commodities worldwide are likely to be increasing, because China has been one of the big buyers, stockpiling things like copper just to have it on hand, figuring it's a better investment than U.S. Treasuries. China bought no U.S. Treasuries in the last year. That's a major shift. They were buying $200 and $300 billion a year. Japan was buying them before that. Oil countries are still buying some. London, as a kind of proxy for maybe other oil companies who don't want their name on it and call it, you know, purchased through London as a money center, have been buying our treasuries. But overall, who's going to buy our government debt if the Chinese don't? Well, the Fed will. The Fed's QE3 is sort of already geared up, and I would say that the Operation Twist is failing. The 10-year treasury, when it was 1.68% at its low in September, I wrote an article for the last Casey report that said, hey, I think rates are much too low. I think they could rise to 2.4%. Guess what? Today's auction almost failed. 7 years, $30 billion, as the rate came in higher than expected, and the 10-year also moved up at 2.4%. I'm getting a little long-winded. The point I'm saying is the effects of a Chinese collapse, including not buying our treasuries, could be pretty bad on our interest rates, which have been helped by them buying them. And I think the price of commodities could be, I'm not so clear on how this works in denominated in a depreciating dollar, but I think the tailwind of their buying in excess is likely to go away as well, and have to be a little more careful about world markets with a potential Chinese collapse after the European collapse, after all of this gets on the road here.